Hey, boys and girls, my name's Tom Suozzi. I'm the congressman from this area, and I've been asked to read a children's book to you. And it's going to take about 15 minutes. This is one of my favorite books, children's books ever. It's called Children of the Forest. My wife was a school teacher. She picked it out for me for our kids. And when I was the mayor of Glen Cove and the county executive of Nassau County, I used to read it to different school children at different schools throughout Glen Cove and Nassau County. So I'm happy to share this with all of you now. And again, it'll take about 15 minutes. So this is Children of the Forest by Elsa Beskow, B-E-S-K-O-W. I gotta wear my glasses because it's a very small book. Deep in the forest, under the curling roots of an old pine tree, was a small house. Warm and dry in winter, cool and airy in the summer. It was one of the home of one of the forest people. He lived there with his wife and four children, Tom, Harriet, Sam, and Daisy. Wild strawberries and mushrooms grew by their door, and they had all the pots, pans, chairs, beds, tables, knives, forks, and spoons they could possibly need. Sheltered under the pine tree branches, they hardly felt the autumn gales, and if it rained, the children crept under a giant toadstool to keep dry. And these are the pictures that are here. This is the kids under the toadstool when it's raining. And this is the house with everybody there. You can see all the different kids. The little one is Daisy. Okay. So let's go to the next page. All the children wore red and white spotted caps. If strangers came into the forest, they curled up still as stone for all the world like four red and white spotted mushrooms. But most of the time, they were perfectly safe. Then they played at hide-and-seek with squirrels who lived upstairs in the tree. Squirrels were scatty, thoughtless creatures, and sometimes they forgot what game they were playing, and then the children could catch them. Mostly they were kind-hearted, and often they remembered to bring Harriet a nut or two from their store. And this is a picture of the squirrels. You can see Harriet up there with the squirrel and the other kids, and they're playing hide-and-seek. And here's a picture of them with their caps on, looking like mushrooms and being still when people came around. On summer evenings, the children went down to the pool to see their friends, the frogs. Buffo, who was big and fat and kind, was especially fond of little Daisy, and he would always listen to her troubles. Here's a picture of Daisy with Buffo. "Renata," shouted Harriet, "come and tell us how many insects you've caught." Renata, the bat, pretended to be very angry at being disturbed, but secretly, she liked playing with the children. Sometimes she would even give Harriet a ride as long as she promised to hold on tight. Oh, so Harriet's riding on the back of the bat, and the kids are playing down by the pond and some frogs there. Here's a picture just playing with the frogs. Not everyone in the wood was friendly. Vara the viper once lay in wait for the children as they played under the pine tree. Their father saw him hiding in the ferns and ran out in his thick pine cone suit with his birch bark shield to fight the snake. Tom, Harriet, Sam, and Daisy watched, and as the battle went first this way and that, but at last their father was so quick with his needle-sharp spear that he pinned the viper to the ground. Proudly, the four children picked up the dead snake. "Where shall we bury him?" they asked. And here's the kids taking the snake, go bury him. And this is the dad fighting, wearing his pine cone suit. The kids watching on, he's fighting the Vara the viper. Just as the children were wondering what to do, an old hedgehog came shuffling up. "I'll take that away," he offered with a sly grin. He scuttled off, dragging it so fast that the children forgot to ask him where he was going to bury it. I don't think he was going to bury it. I think he was going to eat it. Then Tom and Sam cut hawthorn spears of their own and poked them in the ant's nest, but the ants swarmed out to defend their home and stung the boys until they cried. "Silly boys," said their mother, as she put dock leaf ointment on their stings, "never hurt the creatures of the forest unless they mean you harm." Oh, that's good advice, Mom. Here's the boys sticking their spears into the ant's nest, but then they get bitten and their mom's putting ointment on them because they're crying because they get bitten by the ants. And here is the hedgehog coming to take the snake away. Like I said, he probably ate it. In the middle of the forest is a cave where the troll lives. No one knows his name. One day when the children were out berrying, picking berries, Tom saw that the biggest blueberries grew closest to his cave. I'm going up there, he said bravely. And so am I, said Sam and Harriet and Daisy. Ho, 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 said a huge voice above them. Berries and baskets tumbled everywhere as the children scrambled back down the slope. They didn't even look back to see who it was. If they had, they would have seen the old troll of the forest laughing. It was not often that he had a chance to give someone a fright. So here's the old troll, and he's laughing. And the kids are scrambling, and their berries are dropping. Soon they were in the middle of the harvest time, and everyone had to do their share. The little brown cupboards in the roots of the pine had to be filled with bottles of berry jam, dried seeds, nuts, and fruit to last through the winter. The children's father showed them how to recognize the little pearly white button mushrooms, which would make delicious pies and pudding when the snow was thick on the ground. Sam did not want to listen and sat playing with his apple pip, but his father was very angry. Sam, if you make a mistake, we may all die. You must never pick a mushroom unless you know it's good to eat. Oh boy. So here's the dad. He's yelling and Sam's upset over here. And here's everybody picking up berries and cutting down mushrooms and storing them for the winter. Everyone's hands were sticky with berry juice, and the house was full of the smell of newly picked mushrooms. Harvesting was over, but there was still a lot of work to do. The fruits must be cleaned and polished, for one rotten berry could spoil the whole crop. Every ripe brown nut was stored neatly away, and each mushroom carefully sliced and threaded so it could be hung out to dry. The children picked cotton grass and combed it smooth so their mother could spin it into silky thread. Then she would weave it into rugs or knit pretty creamy white sweaters for the winter. That's nice. So here's everybody working, getting the nuts and berries ready. And here's getting all the cotton to the mom combs it out and makes it into silky white sweaters. And you can see the mushrooms hanging up on the thread up top here. The days grew shorter and the moon shone bright and cold as a silver coin, cutting little gray shadows in the pine branches and telling all the forest creatures that summer really was at an end. Mist settled in the hollows like white breath, and the children played at leapfrog with the rabbits until it was time for bed. Sometimes they found forest fairies, dancing and singing in the moonlight and joined in their games. Come back tomorrow night, the children would beg. Perhaps, laughed the fairies, as they slipped away, light as thistle down, there's no telling where or when they would return. So here's the kids playing with the fairies. Looks like they're doing seesaw or something like that. There's the two kids over here and two more. I think that's a frog right there. Here's a rabbit in the back. They're playing. This is everybody looking up at the moon.
Today we're going to see Mrs. Owl, said the children's mother. It's time for you three, Tom, Harry, and Sam, to go to school. I guess Daisy wasn't ready yet. Mrs. Owl knows more about our plants, trees, and flowers than anyone, and she will teach you all the ways of the forest. Tom, Harry, and Sam looked up at the huge dark eyes of the old owl and felt shy, and for once, they did not say a word. Oh my goodness.
So here's everybody going up to the tree to see the owl for school, and here's the kids meeting Mr. Owl. And looking down very shy, getting ready to go to their school with the owl. The owl must be very smart with your teachers.
There were many other animals in school besides Mrs. Owl. Oh, Mrs. Owl, not Mr. Owl, Mrs. Owl. There were many other animals in school besides Mrs. Owl's own three children, and some of them the children knew already. There were two cheeky hedgehogs, two small frogs who had only just stopped being tadpoles, some of the older squirrels, five rather silly rabbits, and lots of small birds, chaffinches, tits, and jays, and even a young woodpecker. Mrs. Owl taught them the language of all that squeaks, swims, flies, or runs. She taught them to listen to the message of the wind and to see the approach of spring even before the first snowdrop. She taught them to keep well hidden from humans and to be wary of all hunting animals, fox, stoat, and dog.
So here's some of the
hedgehogs, the cheeky hedgehogs and the birds going to school. And here's everybody sitting for school. Who do you see there? The rabbits and the squirrels. There's the Mrs. Owl's three kids. And there's the Harriet and Tom and Sam. And those are the different birds. I think that's the woodpecker right there. That one's the woodpecker. Then came the first winter weather. The wind shrieked through the pines, scattering dead leaves and twigs and sending little animals tumbling to their warm homes. The children's father put up a heavy wooden door to make their home weather tight as the first white snowflakes began to settle. Shivering, the children put on thick sweaters and caps and stepped out into the bitter cold. Even the hare had put on his winter coat. If only we could sleep right through until spring like dormice, grumbled Sam, as he helped his mother with the firewood. Oh boy, it's gonna be a cold winter. There's everybody sleeping in bed. And this is everybody outside with their nice sweaters that their mother made with the silky white cotton. And the dad putting the door up. And that's a hare. That's what they call rabbits sometimes, a hare, H-A-R-E. Next morning, the sky was clear, bright blue and snowy. Branches glittered in the sun. Shouting with excitement, the children ran outside, stamping in and out of snowdrifts, rolling in the snow until they looked like huge snowballs themselves. The hare was happy as the children and he raced up, looking for a new game to play. Tom and Sam harnessed him to a sled, and away they went like the wind. Ooh, look at that, the rabbit is pulling them in a sled. See that, Tom and Sam? Here they were playing in the snow. Isn't that fun? Harriet, Daisy, called their father. We must make up a basket of food from our cupboards. It's been so cold that some of our friends may have not had enough to eat. Isn't that nice? Helping the people that didn't have enough to eat. That evening, sleepy and warm, the children sat around the fire listening to their father telling stories his father told him when he was a boy about trolls and fairies and storms and strange cities from long ago. Here's everybody helping to feed everyone that didn't have enough food. They're bringing it, the whole family's there. And then here's everybody around the fire and the dad's telling stories about the old days, the trolls and the fairies and cities from long ago. Winter days, dark and snowy, went by one after another until at last the first warm breeze. Spring was in the air. Anemones and snowdrops raised their cool white heads, and branches became thick and knobby with new buds. Birds began singing and melting ice splashed into every stream. Everything was rustling and restless and the children raced about almost mad with excitement. They paddled and splashed in the stream, damming it to build a water mill. No one cared how wet or muddy they were, for no child of the forest can ever catch cold. Wow, wouldn't that be good? Nobody could catch cold. There's the kids all playing in the stream, making a little dam, they're making a water mill. Having fun. See that? Springtime coming. And this is the end. Everyone in the forest was busy in the bright sunshine. Birds began gathering twigs and moss, and soon from every nest and burrow came the cry of newborn creatures. Tom, Harriet, Sam, and Daisy were amazed to find that they had a new, round, pink baby brother of their own, too. A new year was beginning in the forest, and this is where we must leave the children. But if you like, think about them and their forest friends, and that way their story will never end. Here they are, the whole family, there's a little baby in there. They had a new baby, and there's some birds that had a new baby up there too. So that's the end of our book. Isn't that good? It's my favorite book. So I know you're not in school these days, but I hope that you're having a nice time at home with your families and everybody's behaving and still trying to learn as much as possible. It's been great spending some time with you, and we finished a little early. I said 15 minutes. It's only been 14 minutes and 22 seconds. Okay, bye, everybody. This is Tom Suozzi. I'm your congressman for the area. Nice to see you. Bye-bye.